Black body radiation, as you should all very well be familiar with by now, simply says that anything that, for instance, anything that is generating radiation at a higher temperature than something else is emitting more radiation at every single wavelength than a cooler body. This line will never go below a cooler object ever. This would never go up above another one. None of them would go down less than another one. Something that is at 12,000 K will generate more radiation at every single wavelength than anything cooler. Okay. And some of those, and every single thing generates at a maximum wavelength that produces most of its radiation at. And for the OBA stars, the maximum wavelength is going to be in the ultraviolet part of the spectrum. The FGK stars are in the visible part of the spectrum. And the M stars, their maximum wavelength is in the infrared part of the spectrum, but you still see, even though something has its maximum wavelength in the ultraviolet, it still, of course, produces radiation in the optical part of the spectrum, and that's the part of it that we see with our optical telescopes. But they all produce radiation through all wavelengths. Now, these smooth lines that we see that we're familiar with in textbooks, of course, are ideal. But we know that you really have all the absorption lines because a stellar atmosphere is a very good approximation of a black body. All of the radiation that's being emitted within the star is being absorbed by the stellar atmospheres as it leaves the star. So we see the absorption lines from the radiation leaving the surfaces of stars. And we know that stars, yes, they're mostly hydrogen and helium, but they also have that 1 or 2% of everything else. And all of those different elements all have emission and therefore absorption lines of their own, depending upon the temperature of the object. So when we look at a spectrum, and this is only the optical part of a spectrum, we see all these absorption lines from everything that's being emitted and then absorbed before it leaves the surface of the star. So this is a spectra of the sun. If I printed that out on an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper and cut it all into the individual strips, it would be 42 feet long. And that's only the optical part of the spectrum. But we take all of this optical part and we mush it into this one cartoon of all of that and call that the spectra for an O star through an M star. So we have these little cartoon bars that show the optical part of the spectrum with the major absorption lines on them. But this is actually more what they would look like if you looked at the plot of the spectrum instead of the image of it. This little barcode-y thing is an image. If you want to do any kind of measurements, then you can't use that. That you have to sort of turn it on its side and look at those absorption lines underneath, and that's called a plot. And you can see that these absorption lines match up in both position and intensity with these absorption lines up here. And if you take the hydrogen bomber lines, put them on a transparency and put them on top of the sunspot, you can see that all four of those hydrogen bomber lines are present in this particular star. But however, these two major absorption lines here are not bomber lines, hydrogen. That's not hydrogen. It's actually that double calcium line that is an indicator of a G-type star like the sun is. So you need to have a really good understanding of spectra, of absorption lines, understanding that bomber lines are not visible in the hottest stars or the coolest stars for various reasons. They're not visible in very hot stars because there is so much energy that they're stripped away. Hydrogen's electron is stripped away. It's all ionized, and if the electron isn't there, it can't fall back down to the bomber line. In the really cool stars, there's not enough energy for the hydrogen electron to ever leave. it's a ground state level, so you don't see them there either. So you need a combination of both hydrogen and Fraunhofer lines to understand what the stars are. So again, this is again black body. Planck's law is basically black body radiation law, that every object that is emitting radiation, a hotter one will emit it, more of it at every single wavelength than a cooler one. Wien's law simply says that the hotter the object is, the higher the frequency of the emission is, and therefore there is a specific relationship between the peak wavelength that's emitted and the temperature. Temperature, the maximum wavelength, is equal to 2.9 times 10 to the 7 over T. Temperature is important for every single stellar characteristic. It mostly comes down to temperature. So that's Wien's law. And then Stefan Boltzmann's law basically says that the area under the curve is equal to the power of the object. So if you take the area under the curve of this 6,000 K object and compare it to the area under the curve for this one or this one or this one, then the power will decrease accordingly. According to these two very specific relationships, period, the power in watts is equal to constants. Obviously, the area is important, and temperature to the fourth power. And again, here we go, luminosity, remember, which is related to absolute magnitude, is also equal to the constants temperature to the fourth power and the area. So you see, it all connects together and is basically all the same thing. So we still have the same mathematical relationships that we've had every single year. That never changes. This is as difficult as the math part ever gets. We're more after understanding, but it's very simple mathematical principles that we use. And for resources, if you do not have the Astronomy Coach's Manual, it is on the National Science Olympiad website that I wrote. And if you go to the Chandra website, of course, a lot of the deep sky objects are on there. They have some materials I'll show you on the next page that you can use to prepare for. This is also where this webinar is going to be posted. The webinars for the last previous years are still available also. On the AAVSO website, as I said, if you go to the Variable Stars in Education and Science Olympiad, you'll come to the page where we post. This PowerPoint presentation will be posted. A link to the Chandra, because they're done through via YouTube, where those are posted. And you can, for this particular event, you can look at, download the previous events to use as study guides, because they will be formatted in the exact same way. The first one is mostly ID, stellar evolution, HR diagram. The next one, the second section, is less of that and more of the basic mathematics. And the third part is basically for those people who just live and die for mathematics and physics, because that's where the more difficult questions are. But the remember, the heaviest weight is given to the first part of the event. It also has an entire course in variable star astronomy on the AAVSO website. And some of the deep sky objects, like the recurrent nova and SS Cygni, they have a lot of information about that there. And the very first place to go is to Astronomy Picture of the Day, and do a search for each individual object. The Chandra website has a lot of stellar evolution, basic materials to learn stellar evolution. If you're new to this event and not familiar with it, there's a lot of investigations and materials for you to do. So, you are free to email either Tad or myself at any time. However, if you have a question about anything in the rules or the resources, it is best for you to go to the National Science Olympiad website and ask your question there, because if you have a question, other teams might have the same question. And this will save everybody having to email the same question, because they will contact me and Tad. We will answer the question, and they will post it on the website, and then everybody can see the question and the answer. So, read the event description for content and allowable resources. Use the webinar and the PowerPoint for an overview of the content and the deep sky objects. Use the coach's manual as a guide of how to collect your images. And there's also stellar evolution portions, variable star portions, spectroscopy portions, if you want extra reading in any particular one of those topical areas. Use APOD, Chandra, AAVSO websites for your images and content. Download the 2013 event from the AAVSO website, or even the 2012 event, to use for practice. And if you're an event supervisor who's trying to put together a regional or a state event, if I was doing a regional event, I would only concentrate on the very first section of the national event. I would concentrate just on basic, identify these deep sky objects, where do they go on the HR diagram, where does this light curve go on the HR diagram, does this light curve belong to this object or that object. I would focus in on basic knowledge of stellar evolution in the HR diagram.